Welcome. Nice to see full room again. So thank you very much. Yeah, probably should give you to go ahead. Yeah. So again, welcome and thank you so much to Arista for having us in their shiny new offices and for providing this awesome space for yet another iNOG meeting. It's actually the 8th one. So again, thanks to everyone for contributing and being part of the group and helping us have a lot of these awesome meetings and for sharing the stuff that you do and your projects and your interests, and for drinking the beer that all of these wonderful companies are giving us. So as usual, two minutes of admin stuff at the beginning. So there will be photography, obviously, in case you didn't notice me with my phone in the blender earlier, and video recording. That's more of a worry for our speakers than for anyone else. Now, this mic over here is very sensitive, so even if you're at the back, don't shout any dirty secrets because they will go on. Please put your phones on silent during the talks. That should be about an hour and 15 minutes from now. The format will be, again, lightning talks, so each speaker has about 15 minutes worth of time. It's up to them to partition that as they will. There will be some questions at the end, and please state your first name when you're asking the question. So about iNOG, already some of you already know, but for the new faces around, so in order to interact with the community, the best way to do is to get on Slack. A lot of us are, you know, spending our day there, and we'll answer questions, even technical ones, if you can believe it. But we also have a website. We have a Brothers Defunct mailing list on Google Groups, which should probably get around to actually the meeting. And Meetup, through which I'm sure that all of you have made it here today. There's also code of conduct, so I will read you the short version of it. The idea is that this code of conduct applies to any interactions with the community, be it here at a meeting or online on Slack, anywhere. So please respect it. So basically, the very short version is be excellent to each other, which means that our group is dedicated to providing a friendly, safe, and harassment-free experience for everyone, regardless of gender, gender identity, and expression, age, sexual orientation, disability, physical appearance, body size, race, ethnicity, religion, or lack thereof. So, basically, you've already seen the agenda, I believe, so you know we've got four awesome talks lined up. I will not take any more of that time. I will hand over for a very brief intro to Alan, who will tell us where the exits are and, and stuff, and maybe a couple of words about what Arista is doing in Ireland.
I've been told not to sell to you, so if you want to buy something, let me know. Alan McNabb, Managing Director of Arista Ireland. We're delighted to host the iNOG meeting tonight, even though it's the warmest day of the year. Really appreciate you coming inside for it. We're delighted to host it, provide beer and pizza. Hopefully we'll do this again in the future. We also run the SDN meetup, so we're trying to coordinate and make sure that we don't overlap too much in terms of subject matter. Just a little bit about Arista. I think we're probably the biggest secret in networking. The company's been around for almost 12 years. We were started by a guy called Andy Bechtolsheim in Silicon Valley. Andy was the founder of Sun Microsystems, and he also found the first 1 gigabit switching company that Cisco acquired in 97. Andy's done a lot of work in networking dating back many, many years. But I think one of the most incredible stories is about one of our customers who, the hyperscale cloud providers, are very near and dear to our heart. But Andy was working very closely with a guy called David Sheraton. And David is a professor of computer science at Stanford University. You had a couple of guys that were working on an idea they wanted to commercialize, and they were looking for some funding. And this is their first kind of seed investment. So they pitched their idea to Andy and to David, and Andy said, okay, we'll give you your first 50,000. And so Andy asked, who should you write the check out to? And the two guys looked at each other, and they said, we have to come up with a name. And Andy said, why don't you call it Google? So the founder of Arista is a pretty extraordinary individual. He comes into Arista every day. Engineering is really kind of at the soul of the company. And we take enormous pride in terms of what we're doing in networking. And what we're doing in networking is really about trying to drive open standards, openness and integration and automation. And it's an absolutely fabulous story. I've been lucky enough to be in this industry for about 25 years. I started kind of in very jobs similar to yourselves in terms of configuring networks in 1990. I got super lucky in the early days. And I'm still a part of it, and I think what Arista is up to is extraordinary. So if you have any questions, if you want to buy something, let me know. We're absolutely delighted. In terms of just the logistics of things, there's an emergency exit out there. I think obviously you came in up an elevator, and over to the other side of that elevator is an emergency exit. The bathrooms are at the very front opposite the elevators. And then we're going to have beer and pizza at around 8 o'clock. All right? You're very welcome. Thank you.
Just to mention, people from Arista will be around afterwards, right? So if you're interested, you can just talk to them if you're curious about anything. So, Keith, go tell us why MPLS is still alive, or not dead, or, you know,
or
half dead, or undead.
Hello, I'm Keith. Last time I spoke here, I spoke of a matter that was very personal to me and very personal to a lot of people, with regard to mental health. My feelings on MPLS are somewhat similar, in that MPLS is one of the greatest things that ever existed in this planet, in my opinion, okay? I'm going to talk about a couple of topics, segment routing being one. I don't mean MPLS as far as LDP or SMP, anything like that. I'm talking about MPLS architectures, so something that can signal the label for a purpose. I'll also go through a quick look at labeled IPv4 unicast and BGP. Okay? So the BGP free data center that I did last night. Right. So segment routing, do people know what segment routing is? Yeah, so segment routing is a new partnership, shall we say, between some of the bigger vendors. No offense. Cisco, Juniper. Juniper came in at the last minute, actually. Alcatel-Lucent or Nokia. And some of the bigger carriers, BT, Orange, and Deutsche Telekom, I think, are involved. And basically, it's source routing with MPLS labels. Okay? It allows us to carry out label switching in the same manner as LDP would, but also the flexibility of static or strict hot tunnels within the network without actually putting state into the device. So IP router usually has RCP sessions for RCP traffic engineering. It doesn't have that same thing. I've only got 15 minutes, so if I talk too fast. Okay, so I'm going to show you this all on Nokia routers, okay, because I really, really like them. Pat down the back, go on, give us a round of applause there. These are 7750 routers. I have no affinity with that. 7750 routers, and I've set them up with virtualized KVM. Right? So the main feature or thing that comes with segment routing is what we call a segment routing global block. And this is an allocation of labels that we have to statically configure in the router. Right? So if you look at Cisco at iOS, you start your label range of 16, XOR is 16,000, I think Juniper, I'm not sure, 300,000 you work down, and Nokia is 2,000 and down. So there's no real common ground between different vendors and how their label stack, or label ranges work. Okay? So the SRGB has to be consistent across the IGP domain. Okay? So here I'm using ISIS, OSPF, I'm sure it works just as well. I'm a big fan of ISIS recently. And we can see in the database, okay, so we're PE1, this guy here, and the ultimate goal is to get over to PE2 there. Okay? We have our segment routing global block, which each one is configured with 19,000 to 19,050, so 51 labels available. And we have a thing called the prefix state, the segment ID. And what that does is that identifies the node within the network. Right? This is sent, in this case, in an ISIS link state PDU. Okay? So this is in the link state database. The index 12 means it's the global block as well, right? So the label to identify PE1 in this network is 19,012. The label to identify PE2, because we know, right, we know exactly the database that PE2 has, because it's a link state protocol, we know the label there is 19,016. Okay? So the prefix SID, or the node SID as it's known, it's usually a system address or a loopback address, depending on what vendor you're using. It's a host route, and you allocate the label and advertise it in ISIS or OSPF, and you are able to build your transport stack. Okay? So the top label here in this capture is taken between P1 and P4. Okay? The top label you see is 19,006. Okay, so this is segment routing doing its bit. We don't have LDP here. We don't have RCP. We're not using BGP to signal labels. There's none of that. Okay? Completely stateless. We have a VRF on PE1 and PE2 that are talking to each other. Okay? And within the VRF, we need to have BGP to signal the service label. And that's what this label is here. Okay? So we can see that in the BPM4 BGP table of what we receive from PE2. So, a bit of terminology. The label that we're querying at this particular instance is the active segment, okay? So they're all segments, they're not, they are labels. There is the same range that we have for vanilla MPLS. If people are familiar with MPLS, there's the push, sort, and pop actions. Okay, it's slightly different here. The push is a push of an entire label stack, okay? So we're not pushing to get to the next hop. Pushing the entire stack for the end-to-end service. So if we have a VRF, we've got one label. If we have, you know, a few strict hops in the path, we could have potentially 5-6 labels. Okay? And depending on the hardware capability, it's able to support that or it's not. Okay? So that is one disadvantage of it. The continue is similar to a swap. So if you have your node SID, the label is exactly the same on every network. Okay? So we know that if I receive 19,016, I swap that for 19,016. Okay. And then the next is similar to the pop, but the next can contain an instruction that says, okay, you strip this off, I want you to take another action at this stage. Okay. There are things called adjacency segments, which are point-to-point links between routers that only the local router knows about. So if I want to build a label stack, but I don't particularly want to use P1 to P4 because there's congestion there. And it's the IGP best path, so by default, this is where we're going to send our traffic. I can push this label stack, okay? So the active label is 19,001, it's the top label of the stack. And this is generally pushed by a controller, I should say that. Okay? It's not something that you reprogram in the router. It's a controller that has a link state view. So 19,001 is the label that identifies P1. Right, so if he receives 19,001, he's got a next action against that. So he looks at the second label. Right? The second label represents this link. So he knows he has to send traffic at that link. Okay? Thus avoiding this path here. Now once P2 gets it, once P2 gets it, all he's seen is the 19,016, and he's now going to switch that packet based on the IGP shorts path. Which, for example, goes through P3. Okay, it could go through P4, but it's going through P3 in this instance. we can also use loop free alternates. People know what loop free alternates are. Okay, LFA is a method of avoiding things like micro loops when you have IGP convergence, free convergence. Okay, so if you, for example, lose this path here, yeah, you're going to send your traffic over the top. P4 hasn't received the update yet, right? But the IGP is still reconverging. So he's going to send traffic that comes to him back because he thinks it's the best path, right? And it causes a micro loop for 50 milliseconds, maybe. So what LFA does, or particularly topology independent LFA, which segment routing gives us, is we can compute loop free paths to every destination in the network. a second. Anyone want to talk about it? Right, so here is my LFA coverage map, actually, if you want to call it that. You can see I have 5 nodes from this local guy's perspective in the network. I have 100% coverage, okay? Which means that any break in the network is going to allow me to push on the recovery label, if you want to call it that, avoid the broken interface, and avoid my group. We'll do some debugs. Who wants to see debugs? Got loads of fun. The longer I take, the less questions I have to answer. Okay, so if I want to P1, the not so laborious terminal monitor. Okay, so I have BFD running between P1 and PD1, okay, and it's bound to the ISLS process. So if I shut down this link, because these are vSIMs, I need BFD, otherwise we'll be waiting all day. Close the interface, P1. Boom, right, change happens instantly. Okay. So BFD has made a call, and over here, got an alternative routing table, right, which has LFA prefixes in it. Right? So these are backup paths, these aren't used for forwarding. They have 3 paths out of this particular router. So now that I've shut one down, I've got 2 left. If I bring it back up, give it a chance to converge. Right, now you see the 100 dot whatever addresses are all gone, they're back going through P2, and as the alternative path, and P1 is back to being the best path, the shortest IGP path. Okay? Okay, we'll have to talk about this. Okay, any questions in a second, Rudy, before we look at BGP unicast, labels unicast. Good. Right. This says it all. I said MPLS is the best, BGP is the best. Okay? BGP can do MPLS, so BGP is better than MPLS. MPLS has a forwarding architecture. So here we're going to look at, I know Facebook and people like that, they use like BGP only data centers, they don't have IGPs. we're going to create what I think that probably may look like. I did it last night, so if you work for Facebook, don't point anything out. What we're going to do is we're going to use eBGP peerings between the spine of the data center, the leafs, and the hosts, right? And the hosts are, they're also readers in this example. Do you like my drawing of a server? That's a dicky bow. So we're going to run eBGP everywhere there is this blue arrowy thing, okay? This is the configuration if you're interested. We have IPv4 address family. It's not shown here, but it's the default on these routers. We're going to advertise a label for all the IPv4 prefixes we know. Okay? So if you go back over here, these lightning talks are a terrible idea. It's too much work. Okay, so if you look at the BGP table on what is a leaf node in this example, you see we have labels assigned over here, okay? Trust me, labels. It says it further up. And we're only injecting the loopback, so the system addresses of each node into the network, right? So we don't care about the point links. We don't want to use them to talk to anyone. We only want to get between the loopbacks. What we're doing here, okay? So yes, our TCP session is to a point-to-point link, but it's purely for TCP session. The export policy, similar to Junos, we're going to take that prefix of the system address and inject it into BGP, right? So they're all 192s from the documentation address, testnet 1, whatever. So now we can see what I just showed you. See, it says label. We have a labeled BGP table for IPv4. Again, there's no LDP, there's no RSVP, there's no segment routing in this section of the lab. This is all labeled for BGP, okay? So then on top of that, we're going to do inter-AS option C. Okay, so this is see all these lovely address families, right? The Tesco address family orders your shopping BGP. All of these guys, right? We have VPN before, V6, L2 VPN for MPLS, Mobcast, and VPN. And they're all external peers, but they're multi-hop peers. Okay? We're using two root reflectors that are the spine routers. So from spine one, I can see to get to host one, I have a transport label here. Okay? And the service label that the VRF, equivalent to BGP, most protocol BGP, has signaled to me. Okay? And that's just showing here in packet capture as well. Now, look at all of those address families. It's good enough for Kanye, it's good enough for me. Right? I don't like Kanye, but he looks good at it. Right? So, ultimately, the end game is you want to be able to get from one device to the next, don't you? Okay, so, if I go back into this guy. So we have VPN before reachability, and if you're super cool, we have IPv6 connectivity. Nope. I am obviously not super cool. 13. Okay, so we have VPN before, VPN v6. We can have all those address values, and we never have to use another protocol. The end. Any questions?
What do the labels look like in the IPv4, the unicast?
Sorry, who are you?
IPv4.
First name?
Carl. Uni. Are they attached as communities?
They're within the NLRI, so the BGP update message contains them as a multi-protocol extension.
Okay, yeah, so it is.
So it's just a coding thing. Sorry, I know Carl. Everyone else good? Great. Thank you. Hiya, my name is Thomas Shine. I'm a engineer at SIG. And today, myself and my colleague Peter are going to talk about network provisioning and integration testing, specifically using Ansible and Jenkins. So, let's get started. Don't have a lot of time. We use a combination of tools, and I'm going to talk about Ansible. We're not really going to go into Garrett. Peter's going to talk about Jenkins, and then ZDB Pub, we're not going to go into them. They're switch specific, and we're trying to keep things generic here. So I'm going to talk about the config generation using Ansible. So, why would we provision, or why would we automate provisioning? Essentially, I had a competition, a typing competition with my computer, and he kicked my ass. He's a lot faster, he doesn't make typos, and he does things the same way over and over again. I can do something, Peter will do something a different way, you'll do something a different way. Something I do today, I'll do differently an hour from now. Speed and standardization are really the key here. And standardization especially means for a simpler network, it's easier to understand, troubleshoot, and then we can get back to focus on what we're good at as engineers. So, Ansible, what is it? If you're not familiar with it, it's similar to Puppet or Chef, but it's agentless. It's an automation tool, essentially, but traditionally used in the server world. It's very easy to get started with. Need to know a little bit of Linux, a little bit of YAML, we'll talk about that later. But it's also quite flexible. You can use Python within the playbooks, you can use loops, conditionals, etc. But we're going to use it for config generation, specifically using the template module. So just here is an example playbook. Just so you know, a playbook is just a way of executing a series of tasks within Ansible. So in this case, we have a template.
module, which we'll talk about, and file module. This is just really for an example, but just to show you, this is actually for creating directories, the file module, but you can use what's essentially a for loop through to create these three different directories. We are going to talk about the template module for generating the figs, and essentially we can generate any text-based file. But we take an input, and the input can be any variable within the Ansible playbook, so any call can be something prompted as a start, something you've defined, or maybe a file. So in this case, we're going to talk about BGP.yaml file, and we'll explain that in more detail in the next slide. So, the template module essentially needs two things. It needs some variables, and then we need the input. It needs a template, which is going to be a Jinja file, we'll talk about in a second. And the output is whatever you want it to be. So, the YAML file, it's essentially structured data file with keys and values, dictionaries. The template in this case is a Jinja 2 file, which is Jinja 2 is a Python templating engine. And essentially, the template references keys here, and then the values are split out into the config file in this case. Jinja is quite powerful. You can use for loops within it, conditionals. Now, to move on to our use case, or our implementation, which is kind of, So, what you see on the right-hand side is essentially what we just saw. It's a little bit more complicated that there's multiple templates, and they're all feeding from the same variable file, and spitting out a config. But this switch.yaml that you see up here on the right-hand side, we have one of these for every switch. We were still first configuring these manually, and that's what we're trying to get away from. So we took a step back, and we did the same process over again. So we take some inputs through a template and feed that to an output. And then that output is in turn an input for what we just saw. Now the reason we want to do this is so now, there's a little bit of an initial setup, so we have our global files which stay the same. Typically, we have to create all of our switch type templates, but then after that, for every new colon, we just have to configure one file, it's a site.yaml. It's maybe 50 lines, and then that describes the entire collocation. That could be 13, 40, 50 switches. And we really want to do this so we now have a variable file specific to every switch. And why do we want to do that? Well, that's what we're looking at to next. So this gives us some advantages. The file we have for each switch now is kind of the initial expected state. But that can change, and that does tend to change our environment. So now, as we've got it written in YAML, it's very human readable, but it's also machine readable. So for viewing it and for changing it, that's now a lot easier. And this can be done with Python scripts, it could be some kind of GUI, it could be another Ansible playbook, whatever. The second advantage is we use the same variables that we've used to configure our network, we actually use to test our network. So as the variable files change, the testing doesn't have to change, it just reads into the variables. And I think that's me done at this stage, and I'll hand you over to my colleague Peter.
Okay. Thanks, Tom. So we're talking about Jenkins and how we can apply that to the network environment. Can everybody hear me at the back?
Yes.
Yes.
So the concept of continuous integration is not new in software development. But as we begin to treat network infrastructure as code, version control files that describe devices in the network, we can then leverage the benefits that continuous integration tools like Jenkins actually provide. Right, so this presentation will be talking about how we can actually use the capabilities of Jenkins in a network environment. So there are three main definitions for what Jenkins is out there. There is some people call it cron on steroids. It's cron on steroids because you get the same sharding capabilities that you get by doing cron tab and all that stuff, but you get additional benefit in terms of having a central place where you can view cron jobs across your network infrastructure, and you get additional visibility, additional trending data for each job that actually runs on the network. So when you look at the demo, I'm showing you how that actually works and how you can do that data. And then one more thing I need to mention there is Jenkins has hundreds of plugins, so you can actually build very robust cron jobs. So you can build a cron job that does something, and at the end of the job, you can create a Jira, update a Jira, run another Jenkins project, or do something else. Right, so the second prevalent definition is an automation server. That's kind of a very generic definition, but as we look at later slides and the different use cases in our environment for Jenkins, then this jack of all trades definition makes sense, or why it's called automation server. And then the most prevalent one is continuous integration. So the idea of continuous integration is you have a piece of, so Thomas talked about YAML files, Jinja files, and all this stuff, right? So that's describing what your switch looks like, or what your network looks like. So the idea of continuous integration is you check that into version control, and then when you check that in, basically Jenkins actually then builds all the different pieces of all those files, and basically in terms of building, that could mean performing syntax checks, for example, for those files, or LinkedIn, or whatever, or running specific integration tests that you define to test a specific functionality. So that could be in the form of an Ansible playbook or in the form of a Python script. So I'll be showing you a demo that actually does, that shows this capability, and then I'm talking about this again. And then finally, it's free, so you could go on GitHub and just search for Jenkins CI, and you have access to the source code for the application itself and the plugins as well. So in terms of installation, it's super easy to install. You download a Java application, you can install on different Linux distributions, Ubuntu, whatever Linux distribution you prefer to use. And then you can install on Windows as well and on Docker. And it's super easy to configure, it's simple three steps. So you can quickly configure a Jenkins project in 10 minutes or less. And then there's hundreds of plugins that you can use to make your continuous integration project more robust or more job control. So the way I like to define integration testing from the perspective of config management, config generation, whatever it is, you have all these templates, temp variables, and all these things that the end goal of all those files is actually to build a piece of configuration. So you want to ensure that at all times you're able to actually build configuration in your infrastructure. Right? So you're testing that these different pieces or these different components work together, does the desired, performs the desired function, which in this case is generating config files all the time, right? So you have a scenario where you have, let's say, a rootmap module, or a module that configures rootmaps or BGP, or some other functionality. And somebody makes a change to that module while he was doing something, and he forgets, and he doesn't realize he has actually broken something, and he pushes it out to the repository. What you want to be able to do is you want to be able to detect those problems early. That's what one of the main selling points of continuous integration. You're continuously safe, and you're detecting problems early, because you don't want to discover that something is broken, maybe if it weeks down the line when you need to meet a business requirement, and then you're spending half of the day trying to fix a broken module, and then spend the time you have left trying to meet a business requirement. So Jenkins allows you to detect these problems early and fix them early. So as I said earlier, a simple three steps. You define what your source control management is. You specify an integration test as a new step, which involves basically, it could be a form of an Ansible playbook, Python, or whatever scripting language you need to use. And this is where you actually define the intelligence behind it. So I'm talking about the playbook that we use to test config generation. And then finally, you can specify a code with a post-build action, which could be run on a Jenkins project, or update a Jira, or just send an email saying, hey, something is broken. Okay, so just take a few minutes to look at what a demo looks like. In case you can't see this from the back, I would be sharing this video with everybody again. Okay. So in this scenario, somebody goes in there and while trying to do something on this VLAN module, he mistakenly changes the variable name to VLA instead of VL, right? So he does a git add, he does a git commit, and he pushes the changes down. when we set up the Jenkins project in our environment, we're basically checking, I know some people might have better ways to do it, which there is, but for the purpose of this demo, we're actually pulling the repo every 5 minutes, checking for changes, and running the tests. Right? So I just pause this here. So simple three-step process, you give the project a name, you specify what your repo is, the URL for your Git repo, in this case we're using Garrett, and then here you then define, hey, I want to pull SCM in 5 minutes, and I want to run this playbook here. And then at the end of the job, send an email for every unstable build, and send an email to whoever broke the build. And then, not within 5 minutes, you can also click build now, just initiate the build immediately. So the build starts, and then you see, it checks out git and log, and then here you see, while trying to generate VLAN configs, you see that it's unable to generate the VLAN configuration, because somebody broke the VLAN module. And then, and then you should get an email. So you see an email saying, hey, something is broken. And then in that email, you can actually identify what commit actually broke the build and who actually broke the build. So it sends an email to the person who broke the build and to an email area so you can specify. So you can then identify, hey, something is broken, and then you can then go on git and then fix it. So I'll just move through this because it's a similar process. I'll just move through this. So you're fixing the module, you're doing an add, you're doing a commit, and then you're pushing the changes back. So I'll just fast forward this a bit. And then we can then go back to the project and build. So once we click build now again, we then see that, you don't have to click build now by the way, so we then see that we are not able to generate VLAN configs, so I'll move to the other things like MNAC and all the other stuff. So at the end of this job, you'll get an email saying everything is back to normal. But before then, let's look at other capabilities. So you can see the history of this project, you can see how long it takes to actually run the build, you can see when build fails. If you click this red button, you see the logs. Click the blue button, you see the logs as well at that time. So blue means good for whatever reason, and red means bad. But you can actually change that to green, but by default, blue means good. So that's training capabilities you actually get. Then finally, once the build is complete, you then get an email saying, hey, everything is back to normal, and you fix the problem. So that's basically the end of this demo. So just quickly run through the last two slides before the commit. So, other use cases. So I've talked about this already, how we use, we're moving all the clone jobs to Jenkins. Because of the trending visibility and saturation benefits you get. Another interesting thing about them, because we're version controlling all the new devices we provision, we're then able to do really cool things like, you know, when we add a new device on the network, we can then basically build all the A records, DNS, PTR records for new devices and automatically update the DNS server. So for this, we're using Ansible and Jenkins to actually make that happen. And then finally, this is key to our zero touch replacement strategy because we have set zero touch provisioning solutions from, you know, different vendors. One of them we're in the building right now. So, and basically, what this allows us to do is basically say, the last config that was on the device when it failed, you can actually ensure, because we're constantly building these changes. Remember the playbook I ran that was generating all this config? It not only generates configs, but at the end of the playbook, it actually copies those configs to zero touch provisioning server. So that ensures that anytime a change is made on network, zero touch provisioning server gets the most recent configs. So what then happens is when you take a device out of the infrastructure because it failed and you plug in a new device, it gets the most recent config before it failed. So that's really cool, it has been really helpful for us. And then finally, what else are we working on? This is more long-term goal. We're trying to build continuous deployment pipeline for networking. So basically that would involve, after running the integration test, we want to spin up a network emulation environment, maybe GNS3 or something like that, and push the configs on the devices and maybe run OSPF test, ping test, or some validation test. Then if everything is fine, we can then say, okay, Jenkins basically connects to Garrett and says +1, this looks good. And then the human can look at it and say, yeah, +1. And then once you have +1, for example, you can then move to the next stage of the build, which is basically actually deploying to production. So this is like a long term. This is more near term. So what we're trying to do here is basically to ensure that as we provision devices, somebody might go in there and make a manual change or something that might cause drift between the what you have in version control and what you have on the device. So we're going to be using Ansible once 2.2 comes out to actually, you know, identify these diffs and then, you know, carry out remedial actions, which could be rolling back to a previous approved change in version control, or maybe updating the Git server, you know, if this is a relevant change, or just, you know, creating a Jira and saying, okay, we need to actually look at why this change was made. So yeah, that's the end of the presentation.
I can ask something. My name is Cristian. I was planning to ask two questions, but actually one of them I believe it was already answered on the last slide. But I'm going to ask it anyway. What is your process after you generated the configuration and you push it to the device and you realize that something is wrong? Maybe something was wrong in the YAML file. Do you change the YAML file and generate again and push it, or you go directly on the device and you change it? And I guess the answer from the last slide is that you are actually regenerating and you are working on doing some verification and diffs, right?
Yeah. So that's the part we're going to figure out near term.
So it's not yet done.
It's not yet done,
but we are working on it. And the second question, which is actually kind of related, is how do you make sure that you don't move the human factor from typing the CLI, the configuration, to typing the wrong information into YAML file?
Okay, so that's a very good question. I guess, you know, you just need to test, you know, test as much as we can. I mean, do version control, which is the first step that we have. Having somebody review stuff and look for errors, doing syntax checks. But we can only do the best we can. You know, there will always be issues, and we can only address them when we discover them. But I guess it's just testing, and more testing, I guess.
Yeah, I think the idea is when we configure a switch first, or that type of switch first, it's always done manually. Once that's verified, you know, a new switch type, for example. But then a lot of the time, a lot of switches are very similar after that, and it's just the variables that change.
So,
I mean, Victor, quick question. Which version of Ansible do you guys use?
So we're using
the networking models in the recent ones?
Yeah, so we're using, we started with 2.1 dev, but now the 2.1 is GA, like last month, I think. So we're using 2.1. And the 2.2, from what one of the developers told me in Ansible, is 2.2, we basically have lots of functionalities, like different functionality. Right now, the implementation of this is not so great. In fact, it doesn't exist really. So 2.2, we have a lot more interesting functionality there. Why isn't 2.1?
When you do the compliance, when you figure out the compliance stuff, make another presentation with the compliance.
That's an interesting problem, and hopefully you build some, but that's the plan.
Thank you.
I'm Aaron Levitan, I work here at Arista, and I work on the platform team. I work on drivers for ASICs, switching ASICs and FPGAs. So I'm going to give a talk today about networking with deep buffers, specifically in switches and top of rack switches. So I'll talk a little bit about some of the ASICs available that we and other vendors use, the buffering, the packet buffering capabilities of those different ASICs, what effect that has on bandwidth and latency, and I'll show with some results from a white paper that our founder wrote. how that affects applications in the data center. Okay, so here's a list of a few switching ASICs that are available and have been used over the last 3-4 years by us and a lot of others. Broadcom is kind of the main player these days in data center switches, and they make two very common lines of switches. One line is the Strata XGS. There's a Trident 2, which is 10 gig SerDes, so that's used on 10 and 40 gig ports. The Tomahawk chip, which is 25 gig SerDes, so that's like 25, 50, 100 gig ports. They make a second line called the Dune line, due to an acquisition they made, the company was doing, and that's the Rod and Jericho. These switches are used on both routers and then also data center switches. And these have external DRAM, so these you can hook up, you know, up to 32 and 48 gigabytes of RAM. No one really hooks up that much. Most hook up 8 or 16 gigs to an ASIC. And then there's also Intel and others. And, you know, most of all these switches, you know, besides Dune, the Dune chips use small internal buffers in the range of, you know, 2 to 8 or 16 megabytes. There's others here like Marvell, Barefoot, Expliant, and others. Let's see. So I mentioned the Dune ones have deep buffers. So if you have, you know, gigabytes of packet buffer on an ASIC, what are you going to do with it? So on the Dune chips, there's this idea of a virtual output queue. And this is the buffering. This is buffering that occurs on the ingress side. So you buffer on the ingress, and then you have a pull fabric. So the idea is, on the ingress side, you are going to have a per egress port per traffic class buffer for all the ports in your system. So if you have a large modular chassis with 1,000 interfaces, you would actually have 8,000 individual buffers on the ingress side of each ASIC. And then, so when traffic comes in, it gets allocated into these different silos. And this gives you several benefits. One, as you can kind of see, is it removes head-of-line blocking going out certain ports. Because if you have traffic going in for egress interfaces, E1, 2, 3, you can continue buffering and sending traffic out through your fabric because, you know, the packet buffers are per egress interface. So, as I mentioned, these virtual output queues are per traffic class per egress port. These are just some example drop settings, tail drop settings of these buffers on the ingress side. You do 50 megs for 10 gig, 200 for an egress 40 gig, 500 for an egress 100 gig port. So there's quite a bit of buffering going on here. Okay, so how does this affect switching in a tournament? So, you know, one of the ways you can kind of test this before looking at, you know, actual deployments is you can do a network simulation. This is taken from a white paper that was written. But if you configure an NS2 network simulator with standard TCP/IP settings, you can configure it with 20 servers, 10 flows per server, 10 gig ports up to the Tor, 40 gig uplink. So that means you're 5-to-1 oversubscribed on the uplink. So then you can run some simulations with both small buffer ASICs or large buffer ASICs and kind of see what the distribution bandwidth is between all the different servers. So I've put in the graphic from that white paper here on the right, and what you can see here is that, you know, in this simulation we used 4 and 256 megabytes as the difference. And what you generally see is that there's much larger variability in what the flows are getting when you have a small buffer ASIC than if you have a large buffer ASIC. So in this case, you know, this dark purple one is the large buffer switch. So the question is why would that happen? You know, and that's something called, you know, that we call the TCP/IP bandwidth capture effect. And that's if you have the small buffer in a switching ASIC, you're going to get essentially first come first serve. So if you have 20 servers going to the top of rack wanting to talk, you know, the first person that gets there is going to take as much packet buffer as they can out of that shared buffer. And then, you know, the guy that comes directly after that, you know, a little second later, is going to get much less of the buffer. Okay, so when he, you know, the switching ASIC will accept his packets, and then, you know, after he accepts as much as there is buffer remaining, he's gonna drop the packet, and the TCP is gonna back off. So that means that the person who got there just before has a bigger chunk of the bandwidth than the guy who got there right after. So that's what causes this larger variation when you have smaller buffers on your ASIC. Okay, so, you know, that can cause variations. Sensors, yeah.
So what implementation of TCP are you talking about? Is this big as being a cubic?
Sorry.
What implementation of TCP is this based on?
Of the speed?
Okay, you're testing, right?
Oh, yeah. You know, I'm not exactly sure. It said in the paper using standard TCP IP settings in NAS too.
Yeah, but I mean, we're talking about settings, right? Like, at the end of the day, our personal experience, right? Like, we find massive differences in how TCP, the stack reacts versus, like, if this is Vegas, Reno, Cubic, you know, enough to change it fleet-wide, right? So that's what I'm asking. Because it does very different things, right?
Which Linux do you use?
Yeah, well that, okay, so I
probably use default one.
Yeah, you know, I'd have to look at the white paper to see exactly what they use in this image, and I pulled these results from that paper. So, we can talk afterwards. Look it up. Okay, well, so assuming you buy the results, you know, so you're getting, when you use the larger buffers, you're going to get a fairer allocation of bandwidth, and that's just based on the fact that everyone can buffer the same amount, whether they're, no matter which server they're coming from. You know, the overall throughput through the uplink is going to be the same, right? Whether or not one flow gets more traffic than the other, you know, the overall uplink will be saturated. But if you have some flows that are using more bandwidth than others, and you have something like a Duke Buster, which is taking a bunch of jobs and farming it out to several servers within a rack, some of the jobs, when they come back with the results, are going to come back a little faster than others. So that causes something called tail latency, and that can cause the overall job latency to increase. So that's something that you can avoid. Okay, so this was in simulation, and we can look into exactly what they're doing. So another example is, and this was from a blog post from DataSift, and this is an example of what happened when they took small buffer switches, TORs, and replaced them with larger buffer TORs. And, you know, this is their graph, and in their blog post, I know they did say, you know, what they did with their TCP IP settings, but I'd have to look again, see what they said. And yeah, basically what you see a 6x improvement on overall job latency, and this is just how they're measuring latency within their data centers. So yeah, and then here's the link to the papers. This is the one over the small versus large buffers, and then here's a link to the DataSift results. Okay. So that's all the slides I have. Does anyone have any questions?
It turns out to be new Reno is the answer to the question.
Okay. Thank you for looking that up.
What do you think about ECM?
Like delay-based ECN or early congestion notification. I think people, my personal opinion, people have been trying to come up with ways to delay, you know, TCP backoffs, and there's several different approaches. And I kind of agree with these papers that if you have, you know, per buffer allocations, that's a better approach. Yeah, we also implement ECN and delay-based ECN, so some people choose to use that.
Can you adjust the way you allocate the buffers?
So that's the tail drop setting. So there's two kind of things you can play with. You can play with tail drop settings at a per port speed. So as I mentioned, like the defaults are 50, 200, 500 megs. You can change that. Change that yourself, and you can kind of play with that, and that gives you more or less buffering. There's also a feature called per. You can either make the virtual output queues per ingress port or for the overall ASIC, and the default is overall ASIC, and it kind of depends on your kind of job structure, which one of those two you want.
And can you adjust it like based on like source IP, desk IP flows and stuff like that?
No, we don't have that capability. And I don't think the ASIC could. Yeah, I haven't seen any capability in hardware where that could happen.
Thank you.
So, So your traffic there was specifically at Tor, is it? What would it look like for, you know, what it would look like for more realistic, you know, website
traffic?
Yeah,
so there's actually, I didn't present everything on here, but there, let's see, in that white paper, there's actually another kind of data result, as I recall. Yeah, the leaf spine cloud network simulation is using like NS3, which is basically like a two-layer simulation. And in there, it has the results. And basically, it had a different set of results, but I don't remember off the top of my head what it was, but we can look at it afterwards.
Yeah, can you do a different hierarchy in the buffer? Can you do a tail drop based on the DNCP bit or dot layer 2 or layer 3?
Name?
Well, my name is Patrick.
Yeah, I know.
Well, you know, from the ASIC perspective, you could probably specify it in, you know, on whatever you want. You know, the driver, you could program it for different ways. The ASIC itself, I don't think has a way to like dynamically change.
Right, does it have an in profile and out profile?
Well, all this buffering is occurring on the ingress side, right? So the egress buffers are kind of per port, and they're, you know, regardless of any of the ingress ports. So that's kind of like there's a very small egress buffer, and then all these kind of per port buffers are on the ingress side.
So could we say it's policing on ingress and queuing on ingress?
Well, no, it's definitely queuing on the ingress side.
Queuing
so,
on ingress as well.
Yeah. So it's So that's the difference between a lot of these switch bytes. So this is called like a pull fabric. So you have your very large buffers using the external DRAMs on the ingress side, and then you have very small egress buffers, which are actually primarily used for multicast traffic on the egress, and those will be internal buffers. So in these switching ASICs that use these ingress buffers, there's this thing they call a Dune special packet, which tells which dequeues from the ingress buffers and schedules you across the ASIC to go out the external port through that small buffer. So they basically, you know, on a lot of the, you know, like simple CLOS switching network, you generally do all your buffering on the ingress side. This is the opposite. You do like all the big buffering on the ingress side.
I just have one more last question. Your box, are they top down or do you have different hierarchies in your box?
Sorry.
Your box schedulers?
Yeah, the schedulers.
Yeah. Do you have different hierarchy with the schedulers, or are they top-down?
So that kind of fair scheduler is actually implemented by the ASIC themselves.
Do you have weighted fair scheduler?
Yeah, it is weighted fair scheduler.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for allowing the question to be here.
Presentation. During your presentation about our AS201701, it's a 30-bit ASN, as you can see, seemingly not one of the bigger networks in the world. To talk with you about how to build an internet backbone of pure one rack unit servers and actually without any resources. My name is Oliver, or Takt, and this is Philip. A few words about me. That's Oliver Jams, so I'm Takt. I work in Google in the network edge SRE team. I have a personal autonomous system, which is 19704. My S card a little bit longer. I've been around in Germany a little bit in the hosting provider scene and Nexus. You can find me on Twitter, and I'll give the word to Philip before I go over later on with technical details.
I'm Philip Bernschut, and so I'm a member of the board of Freifunk Rheinland. We are the club to be on this AS, and we are a non-commercial organization based in Germany. I'm the member of the board. I run my own company with software and data center stuff for quite a few years. Yeah, and I'm a fan of Irish steak and Guinness. Is that the reason why I'm here? Because I live and work in Germany. But so Oliver is here, and I met him in a few days. Yeah, you can follow me on Facebook or Twitter and so on. What is Freifunk and what does the FFL? I told you we are a community project and we are non-commercial. We do some research in Wi-Fi and mesh networks. There was a talk at, I think,
iNOG 3 or 4,
yeah. Oliver present a little bit. But today we are talking about our backbone network and the reason why we do this. So, but these are some key points of our community. Empower people to build free and open infrastructure is a very important point because it is about share the knowledge and empower the people to build the infrastructure. Yeah, we as Freifunk Rhineland organize a lot of regional, national and international meetings and conferences to share the knowledge and to bring people together and learn about wireless networks. As Freifunk Rhineland, this is our backbone. We provide IP transit for the most Freifunk communities based in Germany. Yeah, and there's some special point of a few slides about it, that we provide internet access for socially disadvantaged people. So at the moment, there is a situation that we have a lot of refugees from different nations to come to us, and they need some internet access. It's very important for these people. I think all of you here in this room based has your internet access at your smartphone, and when you go at home at company, you have lots, tons of gigabits with internet access. But some of these people came to us has nothing because they couldn't get some access. So, and there's an interesting point that the United Nations see this as we see this as community project. But it's not the situation we have. So the situation is some different. Yeah, we as Freifunk community based in Germany have to fix it. And it's a little bit sad that we have to fix it because we're a community project and we think it's a government task to do this, so but it isn't. Yeah, why it is important to can communicate and to access education and information when you are in another country that you are from, you didn't know about this country, and you haven't, when you have no data connectivity on your smartphone, you can't use such tools as Google Maps or Wikipedia or somewhere else. Yeah, and there's some other interesting thing that the people are using a lot of their money to get some prepaid internet cards because they have anything else and there's any other chance to get connectivity. So, and we think it's better to use this money for food or for family or for other things. Yeah, so, and there's no DSL and no fiber at the refugee camp. And when you see later, I have a few pictures to see this, you can imagine that it's not so easy to bring some connectivity these locations, because it's hard to bring some connectivity in the wild. So there are a few points. There's no business model behind this, because we don't ask these people for money, and it's not our business to do this. But I think we does it quite good without a lot of money. So I think our motto is more engineering and less bullshit at this time. So don't buy vendor equipment. Engineer it, but Oliver will talk to you later about these things. So yeah, bring volunteers and professionals together is hard. For me as a member of the board of Freifunk Rhineland, I have to organize this stuff with the communities together. But we have a lot of different communities here in Germany, and they're autonomous. So, yeah, there are many technical challenges to build free Wi-Fi. So we have mesh networks, and that's a huge problem to get these at scale. So when you have a point-to-point point link, it's not the problem. But we have point-to-multipoint link and dynamic routing over the air. So it's not so easy to do this as so you can open the manhole and put some fiber on it, plug it in your router, and it works normally. So Freifunk community has accepted the challenge, and we built some free internet for many of thousand people in Germany who live there, such as the other wireless communities, such in Spain or in France or in Italy or some of these, as Freifunk is. So I have a few pictures to show you how our setups will be. This is a classic point-to-point link, and there behind this house you have the refugee camp in the city. But the problem is that it's not so easy to install there some Wi-Fi equipment, because you need some view contact between two stations, and then we install it based on the lightning in the lightning system there. Before there was the refugee camp, you can see it on the next picture, this, by installing the equipment. Before they built the refugee camp there, there was some football place on it. It's in my city, and when I was young, I played at these soccer place, and now there are the tents where people live inside. And I could just say that you wouldn't live inside, because it's not so cool. It's noisy, and it's warm, it's hot in the summer, and it's not so good to live there, because there's no electricity. And yeah, but when you find some electricity, the people there are very happy, because they could get some power for their smartphones. And so it is important to have a little bit of electricity. So I told that we provide this backbone. Oliver will present this. And there, before we had this backbone as Freifunk in Germany, we have to get some power. Before we had our backbone, we used some VPN providers, such as Commercial, Hypree, or some other. They're only for single user, they're designed, and it doesn't scale good, because it's mostly OpenVPN, it's a user space daemon. You have to pay per user every month, and so it isn't a good solution. And there's another problem with this abuse. And when it's not your own network, you couldn't handle the views yourself. So, run your own fucking infrastructure. And I told you, it's hard when you do this without great Arista or some other equipment. So, we are looking if here's some equipment we could test it or so. But no, Oliver will tell you why it's not so easy to do it.
Yeah, so that's why ISP. Internet for all the communities, that was our idea, because as Phil said, the VPNs, they didn't scale to what we needed. So problems, no budget, first of all. We had no number resources, we had no hardware, no co-location, no transits, and no gearings, we had nothing. So how it began, it was basically my idea back in November 2013. I was like, okay, it was Freifunk thingy, it was around for a while already, I wasn't participating. I was asking myself, why isn't it an autonomous system? Why isn't it just a part of the internet? Why are they just doing this VPN crap and routing it to Sweden and all this crap? So there were some discussions going on for nearly a year, and then in August 2014 we became a LEA. So we're a member of RAMNCC. We managed to get enough money to pay the membership fee. And then we started first deployments just a month later. Well, so what did that first deployment look like? Unfortunately, we didn't make any photos back in the days. The very first deployment was on one weekend in September 2014 in Frankfurt. So I went to Frankfurt, and a colleague of us, Thomas, went to Berlin to install some machines, and I installed machines in Frankfurt. Just two Supermicros, Xeon CPUs, quad-core, 4 gigs RAM, 4 times ZAS hard drives in a RAID 1, just because we weren't able to access the POP ever again. So I had to add as many hard drives as possible to this one RAID 1 array. So that it takes a while until all 4 hard drives break. Back in the days, we decided to install Arch Linux, which later on turned out to not to be the best idea. And we started with Quagga, which was my fault actually. But there's more slides about this, so I'll talk about it later. And we installed some better machines in Berlin in the Speedbone data center near the Albrechtmann door. nearly same setup and software, and hardware a bit different, and then we had transits in both locations. And a few weeks later, we opened the third corp in Düsseldorf with the same hardware as in Berlin. Actually, exactly the same setup, just a different upstream AS. And this is what it looks like, would look like in the end of 2014. So you have Düsseldorf here, Berlin over there, and Frankfurt here on the bottom. These links that you see between the metros, those are actually not circuits, those have been GRE tunnels over the transits in order to connect the POPs because we had no connectivity. Actually, I see there's a mistake. Forget about on the right, forget about the top and the bottom. They came later, actually. They didn't exist. So it was just one of the first sight. So problems in Q1 2015 that we had then was the inter-pop connectivity was GRE. That sucks. One gig circuits are not really big pipes. Transit sucks. Peering rocks. We had zero peering back then. We had limitations on cross-connects, as I just said. For one of the pops, we weren't able to enter it ever again. We weren't able to get any additional cross-connects. So we could use the 2 gigs, and then we had to move out, basically. Quagga sucks. I will tell you later why. And Arch sucks as well. those were our problems. Here's a list of solutions. So we moved Frankfurt to another pop. We moved Düsseldorf to another pop. The B-Cakes was so kind to sponsor us 10 gigs by 10 gig port on the exchange in Berlin. The E-Kicks just gave us 14 gig ports all over Germany. The Hamburg one we gave, to our sister organization, Freifunk Hamburg. They have their own operating system as well, just locally in Hamburg. So okay, guys, you can have that 10 gig port. And we used the other three. And they also gave us L2 VPN between all the sites. So we had finally transport to turn down the GRE tunnels. It was a great day.
It was like Christmas for these guys.
Christmas and Easter and birthday of same day. The Analytics gave us 1 gig ports in Frankfurt, Düsseldorf, and Berlin. Somehow recently we ended up on GKX. I don't know how that happened. We replaced Quagga with Word, and we replaced Arch with Debian, and then we replaced the Debian kernel with the CentOS kernel, and I'll talk about that in a few slides. A bit more. So the first approach to 10 gig was with HP's NetXen, NIX, and honestly, don't try this at home, and don't try this at work, don't do it at all. What happened was we plugged this card into the machines in Berlin, we connected it to the BKX internet exchange, and they were heavily flapping all day long, every few seconds. And someone in the exchange pinged us, hey guys, your ports are flapping. What the hell are you doing? And then we checked the DMS and we've seen that the firmware on the drive, on the card was resetting itself every few seconds. Just because we don't know why. And then we tried to upgrade the firmware off the NIC and the same thing happens again and again and again, and there was no software upgrade for at least a year or so. So we just decided to kick it out. And we replaced it with Mellanox cards in the Connectix series. So we use dual port 10 gig cards for Mellanox now. And we tried it on kernel 4.2, which was the default in the Debian. And turns out you have to disable all the offloading when you do forwarding and software, which we did. And the result was, oops. So I still don't know why it came to the idea to do generic receive offload here, even though we switch it off, right? It was still doing this. And whenever we put GRE packets over the links, it crashed. Always, persistently. And it took like 5 minutes after Andrain the box crashed. So what did we do? I looked into the kernel code actually, and there was an if construct asking, is this packet eligible for offloading? And then just rephrase that nothing was able to be offloaded. Compiled it, loaded it, was stable for half a day, and then crashed again, and then just gave up. So what we do? Downgrade. So this is what's running now. You can see it's kernel 3.10. You get this EL, who knows what this means?
Enterprise
Linux. This is CentOS. This is CentOS kernel, and then Look at this. Did you see that in question?
Jeez.
So, yeah, we took the RPM package, we piped it through the agent binary and had a Debian package, and then we booted it, and since then, finally, it's stable. So, software routing is pain, yes, that's what I would say. And yeah, it's just bugger at work. It's just doing random things. So look in your rib in Swagger. It looks fine. You check the fib in your Linux routing kernel, in the Linux kernel, and it's just doing something completely different. And you wonder why you have routes in your network, and we always had to just restart Quagga on a core router with full routing table, hoping that this time it will go right. most of the time it did, and then after a few days, we had the issue again. Somebody came to us, hey, there's a routing group on your network, can you please investigate? And yeah, it was eating up a lot of time, and later on, just replaced Quagga with Word, and since then, there's zero pain. So if you can avoid Quagga with full routing table, I highly recommend to do that. After all these changes that I listed up, this is how our network looks like today. The three pops are still there. The connectivity is way better. It went from 3 gigs to something 80-ish gigabits per second that we have at the moment. We are on plenty of internet exchanges. We have transits. Actually, we have more transits than we want to have. Or some of them, we want to turn one on and the connectivity got worse. Because of them, because suddenly packets went through Cogent that were going by a proper path previously. stuff like that. No issues at the moment. Here are some pictures of what the hardware looks like. This is the Frankfurt port that I've just moved 2 weeks ago again. Nothing special here. We use switches on the circuits nowadays in order to connect stuff like the EFIX in Frankfurt is just actually one circuit that we get, but we want to have a number of routers just in case we have to do the router, so we don't lose the old internet exchange, so we put it on the switches, and this is what you can see here. There's some switches from friendly companies who are willing to donate.
Probably Arista.
Maybe Arista can provide us. Jericho is out of the full table, I heard, right? this is the Düsseldorf pop. Actually, the Freifunk stuff is just these two boxes here in the bottom. Meanwhile, it's in the switch in this rack as well. It's missing on these pictures. This here is my personal setup, just in case that I'm not busy enough with the Google network and the Freifunk network, then I do my own as well. But it's just.
I call it the ECMP monster. You're seeing the patches there.
Yeah, it's fully patched, just in case something breaks. We do the same on Freifunk actually. So to do in Q3 2016, all problems are solved. The only to do is use more bandwidth. And this is what traffic levels look like nowadays. So we push like about 5 gigs in software without any pain. And it works. And thanks to all our sponsors, I think half the internet in Germany is supporting us nowadays. We haven't got any new internet exchanges and transfer capacity, also transit, but depends a bit on whatever it is. So if you're willing to support us, reach out to us. We are very thankful for that. Any questions?
Sorry, how much traffic are you sending to the? How much of the traffic are you sending to the exchange versus your transit
providers? We can't really differentiate that clearly because we have some transits on the exchange. So there are some companies that supporting us with transit, but they don't want to have a dedicated port on the router for us, and so we can't really say how much is the transit and how much is
but it's a lot.
How much is most of the traffic is peering. That is because actually what the traffic flow is, we get the traffic from content providers and we give it out to hosting providers. So this traffic comes from Google Network and we give it out to OVH, for example. So it's all coming in via peering and it goes out via peering. So I think we have maybe 20% of the traffic is actually transit.
There was another question.
Yeah.
What's the approximate amount of users?
Sorry, my name. What's the approximate amount of users you serve?
Users? How many users?
Some
thousand of it. I don't know, because we don't tracking the users, or there's no registration. Or
we're not tracking it, and actually we are giving the transit to groups in Germany that are participating in Freifunk, and to local groups, and we don't know how many users they have. We're not accumulating that.
We give
there's also some legal reason for this.
Yeah. We give them some BGP session and GUI tunnel for their infrastructure stuff, and we don't know how many nodes behind this.
And the first nodes actually now are getting direct connectivity. I'm sure here on the weather map, you can see that here, this is Essen, this is Philips local community. They're actually connected with the cable now, with 100 megs. And just yesterday or 2 days ago, I turned up in Düsseldorf for the local Düsseldorf community, but they also have an antenna on the roof, and they're getting this. Most of the others, they still have GUI tunnels to some hosting company.
So the goal is to get some fiber on the roof, we call it, to put the antenna on the roof and have fiber into the building, and then bring it into the mesh network without DSL or any other hacks. So we call it hack as the VPN. So have internet in the mesh network is the goal, but it's a long journey to have it.
Yep.
And Patrick is my name. You have Bird running natively inside the CentOS. And did you have to do any CPU pinning, or you had to allocate all CPUs to network resources in there?
We've been running short on CPU resources once in Frankfurt, but it was because there was a dual core CPU running until like 2 weeks ago when I went to Frankfurt again to swap the CPUs. We tried to solve that with CPU pinning on the dual core. So the Mellanox cards, they have four queues. We tried to solve that with CPU pinning, but that didn't really help. And with the quad cores, we just run IRQ balance.
Yeah.
And it works very
well. That's why I was
asking.
Did you enable IRQ balance?
I think it's more important to have at least the amount of CPUs that you have in queues on your link. So the amount of CPUs should at least be the same or exceed the amount of queues.
Because by default, you only get one CPU for an enable queue.
Yeah, but it's fine.
Yeah.
As long as the CPU is quick enough and
yeah.
can serve that one queue.
But then you could load balance hash across multiple CPUs if you want.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you turn off hyperthreading, or do you kind of leave it, you know, for multi-core, like, so you have multi-core, let's say you've got two 6-cores, so 12 or 24 versions, which ones do you go
so
for?
So we have the same CPU at the moment everywhere, and that means CLV3 CPU is not having hyperthreading, so there's no experience with that.
Okay.
So everyone, for those of you who don't know, my name is Donal. I'm also one of the organizers of Cristian. I'm just going to close us out, just do a quick wrap up. Once again, thank you very much to the lads from Freifunk. It's pretty awesome. Just on that note of thanks, a really quick thanks to Alan and Aaron. Can I say Aaron? Aaron? Aaron. More Irish style. In Arista for hosting us this evening. We're going to go very, very shortly and go to the cafe that you came through and grab some beers and a bit of food. I'd also like to give a big shout out to Lorcan from HEANet for doing the video stuff. All the presenters this evening, so this is volunteer-based, volunteer-run, people come up here, Phil came over from Germany, and we've also had like people from RIPE NCC come over just for iNOG, which is kind of special. Again, as Cristian said before, a very, very tiny bit of admin. This is just a call for talks, demos, or topics for future meetings. This is for you, the community. But that also means that we've got to like pump some energy into it. So if you want to do a talk, if you want to do a demo, if you like what you see here tonight, or you want to expand on something or give a different spin, please just get in contact with myself or Cristian on Slack, on email, or via the website. We've got two more iNOGs up and coming. So iNOG 9 is on September the 21st, location TBD. We're just figuring out one of two locations. iNOG A, which is 10, is November 24th at SIG, so you know the where's Peter and Thomas, they presented earlier, so you can find out a little bit more about them. Very interesting space, beautiful space in November. Also, if you can help in any way, if you're interested in sourcing content, if you know locations, if you want to help do a little bit of PR, right? A bit of admin, help us out with tools, graphics, design, whatever. Again, just hit us up on Slack, jump into the, we're trying to build like a program committee just for, you know, sourcing content and doing shaping where we go a little bit. That's pretty much it. Pizza in the cafe, and then 9:15 we're going to start like nudging you guys out if anyone wants to go for a beer after in BrewDoc. We've told them that some of us are coming. And that's pretty much it. Thank you very much for coming tonight.